Hello, my name is Claire Michkowski and I am a member of the Dole Institute's Student Advisory Board. Welcome to the Dole Institute of Politics and thank you for attending today's program. The Dole Student Advisory Board is composed of KU students committed to the work of the Dole Institute. We attend regular meetings, assist in events like this, and plan an SAB-sponsored program every semester. Members of the SAB receive great opportunities to network with our special guests. If you are a student and would like to join, please contact the Dole Institute. If you would like to know more about supporting the SAB and other Dole Institute activities, please contact our development coordinator, Clarissa Unger. The Dole Institute would like to hear from you. If you enjoy today's program, please let us know by contacting us on Facebook, Twitter, or through our website email. Your attendance and feedback help shape future programming. To view past programs, visit our online video archive at www.doleinstitute.org. A video of today's presentation will be available on our website soon. Before we begin today, I'd like to remind you to please turn off your cell phones. After the presentation, we will have some time for audience questions and answers. If you have a question, please raise your hand and a student helper with a microphone will come to you. Please ask just one brief question. If at any time during the program you have difficulty hearing, please alert one of our staff members or student volunteers and they can assist. Introducing our speaker today is Dr. Rich Barbuto, Deputy Director of the Department of Military History.
Thank you very much. I am very pleased to open the fourth series of presentations here at the Dole Institute by military historians from the Command and General Staff College at Fort Leavenworth. We are here because of the very positive reception from you, the audience, who continue to attend. I want you to know that our historians are always happy to volunteer to speak here to such an appreciative audience. Thank you all very much. This year's series is on military innovations. Armies have a reputation of preparing to fight the last war, of being behind in social change, of being reluctant to adopt new technologies, and of being politically reactionary or certainly conservative. This series of lectures will challenge this conventional wisdom. Kicking off the series is today's lecture, Innovation at Waterloo, Three Armies in Belgium. The three armies at Waterloo differ greatly in their composition, reflecting the effects of the French Revolution on European societies. This talk examines the French, British, and Prussian armies that met 200 years ago this June, and how each army dealt with or resisted the forces released by the French Revolution. Our speaker today is Dr. Mark Gerges. He is an associate professor at the Command and General Staff College. He is a retired Lieutenant Colonel of Armor, and as a captain, he commanded a tank company in Operation Desert Storm. He has taught at the United States Military Academy at West Point, as well as the Staff College. Mark received his Ph.D. from Florida State University, where he studied in the Institute on Napoleon and the French Revolution. His research focuses on the army under the Duke of Wellington, and in particular, the command and control of the cavalry arm. He's interested in the battles on the Iberian Peninsula, Waterloo, and the Ulm-Austerlitz campaign. Mark has examined the Waterloo battlefield in 2011 with CGSC students. And equally important to the above, Mark supports KU financially. Both of his children are studying here. Folks, I present to you a recognized expert in the wars on the French Revolution and of Napoleon, Dr. Mark Gerges.
I always like it when Rich introduces me. I sound like such a great guy. They'd like to meet me. Before I get off this, I do have to lower expectations. For a second, if you expect me to talk all about new innovations, tactics, weapons, technology at the Battle of Waterloo, sorry, I'm really not going to, because if I did that, it'd be over very quickly. We can talk about the reverse slope that Wellington uses. We can talk about the Congreve rockets, which have a terrible, terrible effect. They go every which way except the way they actually point them. I'm not going to talk about that today. We're going to talk about the three armies, as Rich mentioned, and really talk about them from the French Revolution. We're going to do a little bit of what we teach our students at the Command General Staff College about military innovation. But before we start that, I have a quick thing. If my daughter Sarah would start this around, I have from a colleague, Dr. Chris Gable, was kind enough to give me a musket ball from the Battle of Waterloo. So just starting that around, if you want to take a look at it, it's a British musket ball. It's 72 calibers, but the actual brown best that it was fired from is 75 caliber, almost 3/4 inch. The ball itself is about an ounce of lead, and it just kind of shows you just a little bit of the technology and a little bit of the firepower that they're going to use in there. And of course, the ball is 3/100 inch smaller because of the buildup of the black powder and how much fouling you would get. And twice a year, the Combat Studies Institute has a range where they actually go out, and I run one of the stations on the Charlottesville and the Brown Best musket. And it's amazing how after about 10 to 15 rounds, you can actually start to feel the ball not going all the way down. After 20 rounds, you really have to start putting some pressure on it from the fouling. So that's going around. So let me talk a little bit about military revolutions, because that's what our focus is going to be on today. This really starts from a lecture that Michael Howard, a historian, does in 1955. And then it's looked at and studied. And what he looked at is the 17th century. And he looks at why Sweden under Gustavus Adolphus becomes such a military powerhouse. And he starts to come up with this idea of a military revolution occurring. And we use this as our first block of instruction for our students. And it really focuses on how society changes and how those societal changes, which sometimes can take generations to do. It's hard to say it's a revolution when it's something that could be 100, 150 years in the making. But you then see it on the battlefield because those changes bleed over. And historians generally say there are 5 revolutions in the last 350 years. So these things are big. We usually describe them as earthquakes. They change the fundamental nature of warfare. The first one is that 17th century creation of the modern state and all those things we love to hate about a modern state: taxing, bureaucracy, counting people, and all that stuff that allows them to squeeze just a little bit tighter to be able to get more out of their state, and how they then turn that into more powerful armies. The second one is the French Revolution and how you take mass politics and how the relationship of the individual with the state and creating the citizen. You're not fighting for the monarch, but you're fighting for the country and the nation. That's what we're going to spend most of our time today talking about. Next one is the industrial and managerial revolutions, really the 19th century, as you start making tons of things cheaply and easily, plus you can then start putting them together with the mass politics and have the size of the armies just expand. The next revolution we talk about is then the First World War, where all these other revolutions kind of come together, and suddenly it's like a train wreck. We can't figure out how warfare has changed so quickly. And we take 3.5 years before mobility really comes back on the battlefield. But that's looking at a battlefield in time and space and depth. And then the last one that we touch on, and we're doing it right now in the class, is actually on nuclear weapons and how that has changed warfare. But I'm going to focus on the first two. And we're going to talk about the 100 Days campaign. We're really talking the period from Napoleon leaving Elba on the 26th of February, 1815, so we're coming up on the bicentennial, comes to France on the 1st of May, 1st of March. Within 2 weeks, is starting to issue imperial orders, and that really starts his new reign, if you will, up until the 22nd of June, 4 days after Waterloo, where he abdicates for the second and final time. And that campaign, and if you're doing the math, it's not 100 days, it's about 110 to 119, depending on how you count it. We see 3 very different armies, and that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about the Army of the North, which is the French army of the Waterloo campaign. And they really are the heir of the revolution. They are the ones that have embodied most of those changes of the French Revolution. And then the Prussian army. And the Prussians have got a problem. They are going to get beaten so badly in 1806 that they have to change. They know they have to change. But how do you take those things that are making the French Revolutionary Army so good, but at the same time not let it get out of hand so much so that it cuts your king's head off or your society fails? And then we're going to talk about the Anglo-Allied Army. And that's a hard one to actually even name because it could be called the Anglo-Dutch Army, the Anglo-Belgian Dutch Army, the Anglo-Belgian Dutch, Brunswick, Nassau, all these other things, which in a lot of ways, particularly in the British Army, just ignores as much as possible what's going on in the revolution. And we've done it this way. We're always going to do it this way. And so we'll talk about these in detail. But let me go back to the French army of what's known as the Ancien Regime and talk a little bit about what it was like at that time period. 180,000 man army in the 18th century, 578 generals. For those of you doing the math, that's one general for every 311 men. We in the United States Army today have approximately one general for every 1,800 men. The Prussian army at the same time has about one general for every 1,700 men. So you can see the French army is just absolutely top heavy. And part of that is how the French kings kept their nobles happy. Pretty much, if you need a job, here's your job. And it doesn't mean it had anything to do with your competency. It had everything to do with your birth and your family. 85% of that officer corps by the time of the revolution is going to be noble. It varies at times under crises like the Seven Years' War that opens up a little bit, but most of those are going to be lower ranked officers, captains, lieutenants that are the non-nobles. But 85% are going to be noble. The discipline of the French army is absolutely harsh, like all the armies at this time period. for example, if you hit an officer, they will cut off your hand. After they're done cutting off your hand, you're hanged. So that's just the warm-up for your actual death sentence. There's no conscription. It's volunteer army, and I say volunteers very loosely. Recruiting parties go out, and they get you to sign a bonus and bring you into the military. And so who joins? Well, it's not the people who are the most beneficial people for society. They're the ones who have no other economic options. And part of it is just the conditions that these soldiers live under. You get very, very low pay, but so much of your pay is stoppage then to pay back for any items you've lost, your uniforms, your rations. They're going to do things to save money, like go to two men in a bed. And as they get close to the French Revolution the money gets tighter, they'll actually go to three men in a bed trying to save money. Notice they don't save money on cutting the number of general officers. It's what you can squeeze out of the soldiers. And what it means is about a third of their army any year deserts. So you're constantly taking in all these soldiers. Despite that, your army age, about half of your army is under 25 years old. So a relatively middle-class or middle-aged army compared to what we're going to see. The French army has performed poorly in this time, particularly in the Seven Years' War. Absolutely terrible performance. And it leads to a number of reforms and a number of reformists that are going to go on in the latter half of the 18th century. It leads them to spending a lot more money on the army and the navy. They're also going to do much better in the American Revolution, coming over here to support us. But it's going to lead to the financial crisis that'll be one of the key elements in the French Revolution. There's two different things going at this latter portion, right, coming as the French Revolution comes. One is going to be this Enlightenment thought, and I'm not going to go into much detail at this right now. But big thinkers, Rousseau, Montesquieu, Voltaire, Locke, all these ones are talking about where does sovereignty come? And what's the relationship between the governed and the government? When do you have a right to revolt? So those intellectual ideas are going around during the French Revolution. But more important for the talk today is the military reforms that are going on. And you have a number of people that are talking about all the different things that we're going to see in the French Revolutionary time period. Things like the column and line movements. Guibert is going to talk about, he has a general essay of tactics that talks about this idea that what happens if a new nation comes up with citizens instead of soldiers. And the quote that comes out of his writing that's most famous is Europe will fall to that nation which becomes possessed of manly virtues and creates a national army. One which would subjugate its neighbors and overturn their feeble constitution like the north winds bends the reeds. And so there's all these thoughts out there how to reform the army. Borsay is going to write a Principles of Mountain Warfare and where he looks at how do you move forces through mountains. You can't go in one big army. You have to split them up into smaller detachments. If you're going to do that, they make an attack, so you have to have all your arms with you. Every detachment has to have its own infantry, artillery, cavalry. It has to have a staff. It has to have its own supplies. And so all these things are out there. But kind of telling of what the Ancien Regime army is like, Bourset's principles are never published. They aren't published till the 1880s. They're an unpublished manuscript that's being handed around copy to copy. Guibert's essay general, which takes the Europe by storm, is published anonymously in London. So he cannot even use his name on it, and it's published anonymously. It's translated in English, obviously in French and German. It's even translated into Persian in that time period. And there's all these other theorists out there. Flaillard is going to talk about the column versus the line. And they're doing experiments. They're trying all these different things to see what's better. But none of them can be actually implemented because there's such a 578 generals who like the way things are. And then the revolution comes. And of course, you know, the Estates General comes together not to create a new government. They're come to raise taxes. And the Third Estate says, no, we're here to create a constitution for France. And one of the other things they do almost immediately, within weeks of the revolution starting, is this Declaration of Rights of Man and Citizen. And it redefines what it means to be a Frenchman and what's your relationship with the government and where sovereignty comes into. And it kind of shows where the thinking is, what they are coming into as they go. So what does it do to the French Revolutionary Army? And unfortunately, if you look at the numbers for the statistics, it's 1794, 2 years after the war goes on, because in 1792 to 93, it's such a crisis. They're at war with all of Europe. They are having to field these armies very, very rapidly. And one of the first problems that's going to start on the actually on the day after the Bastille falls is this immigration of their noble officers. The immigrés start leaving France. They see which way it's going to go. And 80% of the officers that were there in 1789 have left 5 years later. 87%. Think of what that would do if you had a military that loses almost 90% of its officer corps. You don't hear things like, we've never done it this way before. You don't say, oh, you don't hear people say, oh, this is the way we've always done it. You get anything that works is going to work. They have supply problems. The system in France is falling apart. You can't supply all the food that you need for the army. Under an Ancien Regime army, you had to provide the food. You had to make sure the soldiers were fed every single day, because if they start to not be fed, they're going to start foraging and finding their own food. And these guys are being used harsh discipline. They're being kept in ranks, fear their officers, and if they leave, they're gone. Supply problems start to fall apart, and the French Revolutionary Armies come up with this idea of foraging, that soldiers can be trusted. They go out, they find the food, they come back. Some French units actually make this into a system where there are the best foragers, the ones who can find the best. Basically, they can look harder than the peasants can hide it. And they'll be given carts and given told to go out for their regiments, and they are the permanent foragers. That's their job. And then the levy en masse. France goes to war with all of Europe, and suddenly their army is falling apart, and what is going to end up happening is Carnot, the Committee of Public Safety, is going to come up with conscription. And if you notice the line I have highlighted there, all Frenchmen are in permanent requisition for the services of the army. That's pretty clear. Everyone. And if you look at the details there, the young men shall fight. The married men shall forge arms and transport provisions. Women make tents and clothes, serve in the hospitals. Children should turn old lint into linens. Old men mistake themselves to the public squares in order to arouse courage for the warriors and preach hatreds of kings and unity of the republic. There's no one left out of this. This covers all aspects, and it really talks about who is fighting. The nation is fighting in there. One of the things it's going to do is it's going to swell the French Revolutionary Armies. They have about 400,000 soldiers in the field prior to this. The armies immediately after are going to swell to about 1.2 million with all the volunteers that are going to come on. Now, there's all sorts of problems. And I know this is a little bit hard to chart. I'm just going to hit a couple of things on here about this. You have a war with Europe. Right now, soldiers are not a problem. You have as many replacements as you need. What does that mean? Well, you don't have to worry about casualties. It changes your focus. You're not just going for victory or trying to get the enemy out there. You want annihilation. Your soldiers aren't tied to supply wagons and depots. So what you can do is then forage, which means your soldiers will march faster. The Russian army during the Austerlitz campaign does about 6 miles a day. The French army at that same campaign is doing 18 miles a day, three times as fast. Okay, and at time periods like the battle at coming to the Battle of Austerlitz, when Napoleon orders the corps up from Vienna, in 48 hours they're going to go 76 miles. Okay, and then they're going to go immediately into the fight and keep piling into the fight in the southern portion of the battlefield. This is amazing type of stuff, but it's all because these soldiers there, because they want to be there. They're serving their nation. They're not serving a monarch. You have control problems. You've lost all your expertise. 87% of your officers who knew what they were doing are gone. It also means that the French Revolutionary Army goes from an average age where about 50% are 25 or below, it goes to 89% or 25 and below. Think of an army made up of all, 90% people 25 and below. Think about the spree of that. Organizational changes, you gotta break them up into smaller parts, divisions, brigades. They'll actually get to corps under the time of Napoleon. All allows the span of control to get bigger and bigger and to manage all these arms together. There's also tactical changes. You're not worried about casualties anymore. And so skirmishers, you're not worrying about soldiers running off. So swarms and swarms of skirmishers, so many times that you can't even tell where the front French front line is. Soldiers are taught to aim. Most of the time, if you look at these armies prior to the French Revolution and you look at the actual drill manuals, they aren't told to aim. What the actual says, the command is ready, level, you level your weapon, and fire, because all they're worried about is a massive fire going downrange. And if you look at these muskets, they don't have rear sights. Kind of need a rear sight to be able to aim a weapon. And so all these things are going in there. Put those together, total victory. You're looking for a decisive battle, and it really makes the French armies in this time period into just these unbelievably successful. Take that and put a really ambitious and capable leader together, and suddenly you have an incredible system. Napoleon doesn't invent anything. If there's one thing that you can say that Napoleon really invents, it's the corps d'armée. Everything else that his army does was already being done during the French Revolutionary Wars. What Napoleon's great at is he makes it into a system. He takes all these things and systemizes it. So for example, the levy en masse says everyone is in service. The Jordan laws are going to make it into the 20 to 25 year olds, and permanent conscription will be in France. He makes it how you get officers. One of the interesting things of the French Revolutionary officer army is how poorly educated the officers end up being by the time Napoleon's comes to power, because the schools shut down in the crisis of 1792-93. Most of the schools in France are run by the church. The church, of course, is being persecuted by the revolutionaries, so they shut down most of those schools. The military schools don't operate anymore. You get this huge influx of motivated and ideologically driven officers who come in, or I should say soldiers who come in, and if they're good enough, they will rise up through the ranks to be generals and colonels. But they have almost no education. For almost 10 years, there's really no school system. And so when Napoleon comes to power, one of the things he finds out is about a third of his officers are illiterate, that he has to then do something and starts getting rid of them and get rid of the older ones. So Napoleon really does systemize this army, this system that comes together ad hoc. The French Revolution, no one is taking this French Revolutionary Army and driving it. All these different pieces are coming together just because it's ad hoc. They're trying to put it together on the crisis of France, and they actually end up getting it right. It changes the very nature of warfare, that definition of the military revolution. So 10 years or so, the Napoleon and the French army is going to run across Europe, being unbelievably successful, till the Russian campaign, and then in 1813. And then in April of 1814, Napoleon will abdicate for the first time and go to Elba. And the Bourbons will come back in, and they will reconstitute the royal army. And there's a picture of Louis the 18th, Louis the Zuit, or as his nickname, Louis de Sweat. play on his name because he is overweight. He is filled with gout. The Duke of Wellington, who at this time is the ambassador to France, calls him. He writes, and the Duke of Wellington has unbelievably great letters. If you ever want to take a chance to read, a perfect walking sore, not a part of his body sound, even his head let out a sense of humor. So the other real gift that the Bourbons have is, a historian, John Elting, will say, they had the innate ability of doing the stupid thing at the absolute most inopportune moment. For example, his two nephews, they're going to go out to Alsace, to Strasbourg, and they are going to inspect the National Guard of Strasbourg. And this is that kind of militia force in France, the people who spend, who are probably the most motivated of all of these, but they will go out in that area. Now, that's this time period, Russian soldiers and Russian armies are just starting to pull back out of France after the fall of Napoleon. And they've stayed in the Alsace-Lorraine area. They say that a lot of wells in that area are finding Russian officers and Cossack officers in the bottom of them because the people of the area are a little sick and tired of the Russian troops in the area. So the two nephews of Louis XVIII go out to Salzburg to inspect the National Guard. And of course, being royal, they have all these different honorary titles and stuff. And so they decide to wear the uniform of Russian generals. The absolute worst thing you could possibly do. The other thing that the Louis does is he doesn't trust the army. And he's right not to trust the army. He comes back to power in April of 1814. By November, conditions are getting so bad in Paris that the British government is trying to figure out a way of getting Wellington, who's the ambassador to Paris, out of Paris without making it look like they're pulling him out. They're trying to get him. He'll finally end up going a month later down to the Congress of Vienna to be the minister down there. They're afraid of him getting attacked. They're afraid of him getting kidnapped. They're afraid that the Bourbons are going to fall to a counter-revolution. Why is this going that way? Well, Louis is doing everything he possibly could to tick off the army. All these soldiers who have been put on half pay and sent back out, they have to save money. So they're going to reduce their half pay down to a third pay. One of the things Napoleon does is if a soldier dies honorably in battle and his children are orphaned, the state will adopt it. And he runs five different orphanages for these children where they're adopted by the state. They are promised education. That's expensive. So Louis closes the orphanages. The Hotel des Invalides, their version, pretty much of a VA hospital in Paris. Old soldiers, injured soldiers can go there. They live there at government expense. They get a 750 franc stipend for the year. Louis is one of the things they're going to do is close that, send them back out to their provinces, and cut their stipend down to 250. Franks. So all these little things are just annoying the army. The Imperial Guard, the most elite army in the units in the French Revolutionary Army. The Young Guard, the newest ones, they're disbanded and their soldiers are just mixed in with the normal soldiers of the army. The Imperial Guard does not become the King's Guard. Their pay, they've always been paid better, they've been fed better, they have better quarters. Their pay gets reduced down to just a little bit above the line. And then they're split up and sent all over France, so they're no longer the guard. They create a brand new guard of the king, something that's going to be more reliable. But again, he just does it wrong. He picks all these people who are family members, people he can trust, their loyalty is absolutely known. He does reach out to two Napoleonic officers to try to make that bridge that gap between Napoleon's army. He picks Berthier, the old chief of staff of the Grand Armée, and Marmont. And he gives them, and each of these companies of this new King's Guard have the names of the officers. So there's the company of Berthier and the company of Marmont. Well, Berthier in 1814 does not come back to Napoleon's call. And so the nickname of that company across France is the Company of Peter, because he denied Jesus. And Marmont is the one who, as they're getting ready to defend Paris, goes over to the Allies with his army and leaves basically Paris undefended. His company is known as the Company of Judas. And so just these bad choices. He picks for the Minister of War a French Marshal Dupont. Dupont has been for the last 6 years in jail for treason. In 1808, he had surrendered his corps to the Spanish troops. It's the first time indigenous troops defeat a French corps. He is sent back to France. He's basically court-martialed and sent to prison as a traitor. Every French soldier knows Dupont's a traitor. And who does he make as the Secretary of War? So all these different things are going on there. Then there's also the French revolutionary forces that didn't surrender. For example, Davout has 26,000 soldiers that have been holding Hamburg until finally Napoleon abdicates. Louis XVIII issues orders for them to march out of Hamburg and come back to France. And he brings those 26,000 soldiers back. They're undefeated, they're well-disciplined, they're still armed. And they get back and they say, Napoleon could have only been defeated if someone betrayed him. Nous sommes trahis. This idea that we've been betrayed, because they cannot even imagine how Napoleon could have possibly lost without the betrayal. So Louis has set the conditions, so when Napoleon comes back, it's very, very easy for him to reconstitute an army. And if you ever chance to read some of the accounts where he comes in there, and his personal bravery is amazing. He lands in the south of France near Caen. And he starts moving north. He's going to get there with the first unit. He arrives with the fifth line. They're there. Their muskets are lowered. Their officer actually gives the command fire. Not a single soldier will fire at Napoleon. Napoleon has marched out in front at this point. And he'll uncovers his breast and says, you know, soldiers of France, will you fire on your emperor? And they throw down their arms and come cheering in there. And his advance guard that is leading the way to Paris, he doesn't give him ammunition. He does not want to have a single drop of blood spilled for his restoration. And so by the time he gets to Paris, it's a triumphal march in. Immediately, he doesn't know he has 100 days, but he has immediate problems he has to face and reconstituting the army. Now, a couple of things have helped out. One is the Allies have released all the prisoners. There's huge numbers of French prisoners have been captured over the last 8 years. Some of them held in prison hulks in British bays. They take their old ships of the line that are no longer good for sailing and pack them full of soldiers. They've been held in Russia. They've been held in Austria. They come home. And when they come home to France, there is no welcome. There is no government aid assistance. They're coming home tired. They're coming home in tatters. And they're basically just told, go home. That's it. You're no longer needed. So these guys come flocking back to the colors. The officers of the Army of the North, and down in the bottom, he's going to raise, within about 3 months, 559,000-man army. Now, some of them are in training. About 190,000 of them are training. 270 or so are in field armies all across France because of the invasion. But it's an absolutely amazing feat of bringing them back in. But there's all sorts of problems. There's problems with weapons. There's problems with getting enough bayonets, enough muskets. They're able to make enough of the musket cartridges. Horses, because so many horses have died during the Russian campaign 2 years earlier, they still are never able to reconstitute that. The officers who come back are all veterans. They are an absolutely loyal and hard group of guys. The men, many of these are veterans also. Bold, hard experiences they put up there. They also have some recruits. The one thing that Louis XVIII has done that everyone likes is he's gotten rid of conscription. So Napoleon can't start conscription again. But before Napoleon falls, they had called up the class of 1815. So you had, normally it's a 20-year-old's class that's pulled up. They called up the 19-year-old and the 18-year-old classes. And so these guys had come to the colors, and then Napoleon falls, so they're released. But basically, they're on extended leave. So he recalls all them back. So you get this army that's made up of hardened veterans, all of these experienced victories, and then new recruits from the 1815 campaign. It's a brittle army, though. And I say brittle because Wellington will say, when he's asked about it, he says, are we going to see a lot of desertions from this army? He says, we won't see a single one from private up to colonel. They will stay with Napoleon 100%. We'll see a bunch of marshals and generals, but they won't be worth much. And part of the problem is in 1814, it's the generals and the marshals who are the ones who are going to abandon Napoleon and force him to actually abdicate. And so the officers and the enlisted guys just don't have a lot of trust. The soldiers don't trust that their officers are in there for the long haul. So even though this is probably one of the best experienced and led armies, it has a flaw in it. If it's victorious at Waterloo, it probably would have been one of the best armies he had ever had, but it never is given that chance. So let's go a little bit and talk to the Prussian army, Frederick III. And with this idea of the military revolutions, we usually say there's a paradigm army, an army that epitomizes that particular revolution. They have kind of figured out the way it works better than anyone else. The French Revolution, obviously it's the French army under Napoleon, the revolutionary armies. For the creation of the modern state, probably Frederick the Great, by the middle part of the 18th century, this little tiny state in North Germany, which has always kind of gotten a little bits of land by marrying off people and not fighting, is going to be able to, from 1740, they'll fight an eight-year war, and then in 56 to 63, they'll fight the Seven Years' War. That little army will absolutely make its name because of the discipline, because of the ability to hold off. And they're fighting all the big countries. They're fighting in Seven Years' War. They're fighting the Russians. They're fighting the French. They're fighting the Austrians. They don't pick their sides very well. They do get the paymasters of Europe, Britain. What makes them so good? Well, one of the things is Frederick the Great doesn't want to use his Prussians. His Prussian citizens are really, he says, the value of the state. So I don't want to use them because then my state's not going to expand and not going to be able to develop economically. So he takes anyone he can get, deserters from other countries, impressed people, prisoners he'll get in there. How does he hold this army together? Well, with iron discipline. And the Prussian service of all these armies is absolutely the worst service from that iron discipline. He says it takes 2 years to make an infantryman. And part of that piece is because you have to instill this level of discipline. And what they're looking for, what they call, is the corps obedience. This idea that the soldiers are so disciplined that as they're marching forward, if they get killed, their body will continue to march forward and fight because it's just that disciplined of an army. All kinds of punishments. Any officer can give the punishment. You don't have a court martial that has to do it. Any officer can do it. Things like running the gauntlet. We have 200 soldiers lined up with this birch stick that's been soaked in salt that they whip them as the person walks through there. And of course, he can't go quickly because you have a person in front of you, soldier in front of you with a musket reversed with a bayonet on it that's marching slowly. So you have to stay there and hit and get hit and get hit. What's the advantages of all these things? One of the things is the French or the Prussian rate of fire. Most armies at this time period can get about 3 rounds a minute out as a good one. The Prussians are getting 5 rounds out, so that much quicker. They have probably the worst weapons in Europe. It is absolutely inaccurate, but it loads quickly, and that's why the Prussians want it. If you notice the photo or the painting down there, that's actually the Prussian lifeguards. And if you notice, they're firing in both directions. They are surrounded and firing linearly out in both directions. They're going to win the battle. Other units would have broken and fallen in that kind of condition. And the Prussians just stand there and they take it. And it's all massive fire that they're going to get out. Their non-noble officers are going to go down. During the Seven Years' War, about a third of their officers, their junior officers, are non-noble. But as the French Revolution gets closer and closer, there will only be 2 between lieutenant and major. So only 2 of them. They've reduced the numbers. And Frederick the Great will die just prior to the French Revolution. And really, the way he has created this army becomes the model for any Prussian officer. The Prussian officers of the French Revolutionary Wars are the ones who made their name under him. And they don't want to change a thing. It's discipline. It's standing there, it's taking fire, it's the ability to give more and more firepower out. That's what's going to make you successful. The Prussian army during the Napoleon or the French Revolutionary period is only there in 1792 to fight against the French, and it won't actually close with an infantry fight. It's just a cannonade, and they then leave the campaign. And they sit out then for the next 14 years. Why this is important is because the French Revolutionary armies have begun all over Europe and beating up on everybody else. And every time you get beaten, you learn something from the French. And the Prussians are looked at as this epitome of what a really, really good army is. So as 1806 is coming up and it looks like war is going to come, everyone's like, ah, the French have been good, but you know what? They're now going up against Frederick the Great's army. They're going to get their clock cleaned. These guys are the real good. These are the professionals. But they have a couple things going on for them. They have tried so hard to keep the army of Frederick the Great the same. Look at their officers. They have 142 general officers at Jena Auerstadt. Four of them are 80 years older. Most of them have made their reputations with Frederick the Great in the Seven Years' War. 13 of them are 70-year-olds, and 62 of them are in their 60s. And what will end up happening at Jena Auerstadt, it's a dual battle on October 1806, an October afternoon. Napoleon, with the main body of the French army, will run into the advance guard of the Prussians and will destroy them at Jena. To the north there, Soult, with 26,000 French soldiers in his corps, will come around and he will run into the main body of the Prussians, 52,000. And the 26,000 Frenchmen, outnumbered 2-1, will beat them. And why? Because of waves of skirmishers, individual action. The skirmishers aren't standing out in row after row. They're hiding behind the trees. They're hiding behind in farmhouses and like that. And the afternoon comes, they destroy the main body of the Prussian army. When Davout actually sends the message to Napoleon that I've defeated the Prussian army at Auerstadt, Napoleon doesn't believe it. He thinks that Davout's only defeated a detachment. He'll even send a message back saying, tell your marshal, I think you're seeing double, because Napoleon can't believe the numbers. And it's only going to be in the next couple days as he gets the reports in, he realizes that no, Davout has beaten with a single French corps the main portion of the Prussian army. What will happen then is Napoleon's going to let loose the cavalry under Murat, and they will, in about 3 weeks, destroy the remainder of the Prussian army. And it's not a good time period in Prussian military history. Many of the fortresses that are armed, equipped, have the food, give up without a fight. The Prussians are so shocked by this victory, and they are shocked by the success that the French have, and it's really a national humiliation. The sword and the sash of Frederick the Great will be sent back to Paris to be in Les Invalides. It's an absolute embarrassment to the Prussians in a relatively short time period. What will end up happening is Frederick Wilhelm, the King of Prussia, will set up a military reform commission, headed up by Scharnhorst, also have Gneisenau and a number of other reformers there. Stein will do the same thing for the Prussian civil side of it. But he gives them specific instructions. I want you to review what happened in the last campaign to try to figure out why we got beat so poorly. I want you to cashier and punish officers who did not do their duty. Okay, so we're going to get rid of clean house of those. Propose changes to the organization, supply, regulations, training, education, and selection of officers. All the things he tells them to do are all about fixing the military. But remember, we talked about the military revolutions and as society has changed. And Scharnhorst and Gneisenau are up there and they realize that this is not about how big our battalion is or what our formation is or how quickly we march. We have to change the very nature of who we have as soldiers. And so what they're going to do is, one, is they're going to clean house of all those old generals. Of the 142 who are on active duty in 1806, 9 years later, there's only two still on active duty. They've gotten rid of all of them. They look at trying to do universal conscription like the French, and it's just too expensive. There's no way they can do that. But here starts where they start to get into really radical stuff. They want to free the serfs. They want to create, they said, how can we trust someone to fight for Prussia if they're just a serf, basically a slave, unable to own land, change jobs, move, do any of that stuff. So we have to recommend to the king to free the serfs. They're going to do the thing called the Crumper system, which brings in soldiers to be trained, because Napoleon has put a limit on the size of the Prussian army at 42,000 soldiers. The Crumper system takes the best trained soldiers and basically lets them go for an extended leave, and then you can bring more in. So if you let 10 out, you bring 10 new recruits in, but you always stay under the force cap of Napoleon's soldiers or officers as they're counting how many soldiers you have. Here's the Prussian army that wanted corps obedience, that wanted you to be more afraid of your officers than your enemy. They get rid of corporal punishment. You don't whip citizens. That's one of the big things they're going to do. And later they're going to raise up a landwehr system, which is basically a National Guard type of a popular movement in there. The Prussian Reform Edict that comes out is really interesting, just from the language that's used. The problem is, if you go too quickly, you could lead to a revolution. And we saw what revolution in France does. It ends up having your heads of the king cut off. And so when you actually look at the Prussian Reform Edict, it starts off with very familiar type language. We, Frederick Wilhelm, by the grace of God, King of Prussia, et cetera, et cetera. So there's no question about where he gets his sovereignty, right? God made him the king. And then he goes and he says, we hereby make it known to be understood, every inhabitation of our states is competent. They can own and mortgage landed property. From this date of ordinance, no new relation of serfdom, whether by birth or marriage, or by assuming the position of a serf, or by contract, can be created. And the big one, from Martinmas 1810, all serfdom shall cease throughout our whole realm. From Martinmas 1810, there shall only be free persons. And so that's a really big deal. That changes the very nature of who is fighting for the Prussian state. Napoleon sees what's going on at Memel, and he's going to say, what's going on at Memel seems like a bad joke. These guys are trying to pick and choose what's successful out of the French Revolution and copy it. He thinks it's a bad joke. Well, in 1813, the Prussians are going to join the Allied side in the 6th Coalition, and in May of 1813, French troops will see the Prussians for the first time since October of 1806. And the first time they see a little battle called Grosskirchen, Napoleon's comment is, the beast have learned something. Notice the language. He still doesn't think much of them, does he? The beast. But the beast have learned something. The war in 1813-1814, which is the longest, most expensive campaign of the Napoleonic Wars, ends up being known as the War of German Liberation. They're going to get French forces out of those German states. The Prussian army raises 280,000 soldiers. Krumpwehr system, the Landwehr, almost 6% of its population is going to be there. And of course, only two of the 142 general officers I mentioned is still on active duty. One of those two is Field Marshal Blücher, who at Waterloo will be 72 years old. We can talk a little about him. Napoleon calls him the drunken hussar. He likes to drink. He's also a little bit crazy, I guess, would be the best way of saying it. He will come up to Wellington and say after Battle of Waterloo that he's pregnant with an elephant. The most embarrassing portion of that whole story, it's from a French grenadier. And so he's got some issues. So let's go to the British Army of before the Napoleonic Wars. And there's Prince Frederick Augustus, Duke of York, second son of the king, King George III, favorite son of George III. I wonder how he got this job. He is the commander-in-chief of the British Army, and will stay that way up until 1827, other than a small period in the middle. It's a small army, only about 40,000 at the start of the Napoleonic Wars. But it has no common doctrine. It's coming out of the American Revolution in 1783, where it has fought in small units, regimental and below. And it has no unifying doctrine, no unifying way. So as you start to put larger units together during the campaign in Flanders in 1793-95, they just don't mesh. Every colonel has done things his own way. And so one of the big things they're going to have to start doing is unifying doctrine. The officers. The purchase system is live and well, and we'll talk about that in a little bit of detail. Now, there's not everything in the purchase system is not bad. You have to remember that the Duke of Wellington purchases some of his steps. He is a lieutenant at 22, and he's a lieutenant colonel at 24. Okay, so he possibly a few purchases in there. But the purchase system allows officers to purchase the next rank up. And the Duke of York can't change the system. The only thing he can do is make some time in grade requirements. So you can be a captain, but you have to be a captain for 6 years before you can become a major. You have to be a major for so many years before you can do lieutenant colonel. Because before what happened is, if you had the money, you can just buy every step relatively quickly and move up very, very quickly. There's no conscription in England. And you have the recruiting parties that go out and basically try to get people to take the king's shilling. And if they can somehow get them in there, they put them into the army. So you're not getting the best parts of society. And interestingly, if you look, there's two different enlistments at this time period in the British Army. One is a 7-year enlistment, and that can be renewed at 7-year intervals. And then there's also a lifetime enlistment. So basically, until you wear out or killed or wounded, you are in the British Army. And the difference in the bounty is about 5 guineas, 21 shillings. Today, those 5 guineas are worth $393 as of yesterday when I looked it up. 75% of the recruits take the extra 5 guineas in a lifetime commitment. And what most historians look at is said because they want the drink. They want that one big party. So you sign away the rest of your life for $393 additional dollars. The breakdown here is from a historian, Michael Glover. 29% of the ones who choose life enlistments are English. 26% of the Scots coming in choose. But of the 566 Irish he looked at, only one person chose a 7-year enlistment. 565 chose lifetime enlistment to get the extra 5 guineas. I'm not sure what that says. I will let you of Irish descent figure it out later. There's no conscription, and the conditions in the British Army are very, very bad. They are going to create the Ballot Act of 1802, which is going to create a militia. The militia does not allow, you have to serve in England. You cannot serve overseas. But it does have, like a conscription, it does take anyone from 18 to 40 years old, and then it allows those local areas to select who is going to go into it. So you get a much, much broader part of society. Where under the Prussian model and the British model of pure conscription, you know, recruiting parties are out there, they're getting basically, as Wellington will say, the scum of the earth. The people who have no other options looking at it. The Militia Act takes a much, much greater cross-section of society and a much, much better type of recruit. The Peninsular Army under the Duke of Wellington is really unique because Wellington's there for 6 years and he is able to kind of create the army that he wants to. The Duke of York, as the commander-in-chief, only commands the infantry and the cavalry. Everything else is under different branches. So you have the treasury in charge of food and forage. You have the quartermaster general. And Wellington controls everything, and so he's able to try to keep them all together and maneuver the system to get a successful army. His quote of the scum of the earth, most people never hear the second part. It's really wonderful that we have made them such fine fellows that they are. He's very, very proud of his soldiers, and he looks at this system. One of the things that has changed, the purchase system. You don't have to purchase a rank if there's openings. So during campaign in the peninsula, where you're getting officers who are getting wounded, officers who are getting sick and diseased, there's lots of openings. So you don't have to purchase the next rank. It's just not needed. The only ones who do purchase is where you want to be in particular regiments. If you're a cavalryman who want to be in a particular foot regiment, then you purchase that rank. But for the most part, it kind of doesn't get used much. The enlisted makeup changes quite a bit. What'll happen is they will, in 1805, change the militia law so that militiamen can volunteer for service overseas. And you say, how many are going to volunteer? Well, the first year in 1805, 13,000 militiamen will volunteer to go overseas. At the same time, the recruiting parties to the British Army are out. They only get 10,000 recruits. So 13,000 will volunteer versus 10,000 who are actually enlisted through the recruiting parties. By 1813 in the peninsula, Wellington's army is about 52,000 men strong, which equals almost exactly the same number of militiamen who have volunteered for overseas service in that 10-year period. So that kind of shows you how important this is. And it also changes the entire social dynamic of the enlisted ranks. The problem that Wellington's not able really to deal with is political connections. He's going to get officers that he is stuck with, and until his reputation rises up, he really can't get rid of. Two quick examples from the peninsula. One is Black Jack Slade, Major General Slade from the cavalry. Slade is coming out to the peninsula. He has escorted down to the dockside by the Duke of York, not the Duke of York, excuse me, the Prince Regent, Prince of Wales. He doesn't have a sword on, so the prince will take off his personal saber and hand it to him to carry with him. So it kind of shows just how close the connections are. The other person is William Erskine. William Erskine is a lieutenant general who will command a cavalry division at times in the peninsula. His dad had been the quartermaster general in the American War, fighting over in New York. When the Flanders campaign comes, he'll be the second in command under the Duke of York. His son, William, is an aide to him, his father. In 1794, there'll be a cavalry charge. The Austrian emperor is almost captured. And William Erskine, the younger, will take part in this charge, helping to free the Austrian emperor. So he'll receive the Order of Maria Theresa, their highest award, and have those type of connections. When he's sent out to the peninsula, Wellington has heard of him, because William Erskine spends part of the 1790s in an insane asylum. And he will write to the Horse Guards, which is the equivalent of their headquarters at the time. When he hears William Erskine's coming, he says, "I've generally understood him to be a madman." The military secretary of the Horse Guards is going to reply, "No doubt he is sometimes a little mad, but in his lucid intervals, he is uncommonly clever fellow, and I trust he'll have no fit during the campaign, though he looked a little wild as he embarked." He does get a little wild. He'll jump out of a window in 1813 in Lisbon. And by the Waterloo campaign, Wellington really doesn't have anything like the army he wants. The army has been downsized after the peace, and many of the veterans from the peninsula are sent to either the Mississippi or the Chesapeake campaigns. And Wellington's given all these other forces. Now, he asked for 40,000 British infantry, 15,000 British cavalry, 150 guns, and to pick the staff he wants. He gets a total of 30,000 soldiers of all arms, and he gets a 4-page apology from the Duke of York saying, "Oh, I'm sorry, I should have consulted with you, but I've already promised out all these positions." Part of it is all these officers who've missed the Peninsula War and missed their claim to fame from fighting under the Duke of Wellington are pushing him to be out there. One of them is going to be Lord Uxbridge, who will lose his leg at Waterloo. He'll command the cavalry under Wellington. He commanded cavalry. He commanded two brigades in 1808 and then goes back to England. The person who replaces him, Stapleton Cotton, will command up to 8 brigades of cavalry, so a much, much bigger experienced force. So Uxbridge goes from commanding 2 brigades to the Waterloo campaign, where he suddenly has 5,000 horse that he's commanding. And when you read the accounts by some of the officers who are in the peninsula, they just talk about mistake after mistake after mistake he makes. But part of it is he's connected with the Prince Regent, the future King George IV. You notice the two other commanders under the Duke of Wellington. One's Prince William of Orange, 23-year-old Slender Billy, as they call him because of his real thin neck and face. He'll become the future King of the Netherlands. Slim Billy will command the First Corps, 23 years old. I wonder what his qualifications are. Oh, that's right, Dad's the king. Prince Frederick of the Netherlands, 18-year-old, that's his younger brother. There can only be one Prince of Orange, so his brother is the Prince of the Netherlands. Prince Frederick is 18 years old. He's going to command 17,000 soldiers off to the west. And again, what's his connection? What's his qualifications? Oh, Dad. 71,000 soldiers at the Battle of Waterloo. Less than 30,000 of those are British. And when you look at who they are, they have the King's German Legion, probably some of the best troops in Wellington's army. These are loyal Hanoverians. George III is the Elector of Hanover, and when Napoleon reorganizes the Holy Roman Empire, those soldiers will leave England or leave Hanover, go to England, create a King's German Legion, and then fight in the peninsula under the Duke of Wellington. But he has Dutch and Belgium, and guess where they were for the last 20 years? They were in the French army. And Wellington's letters back to the government constantly talk about, "I don't really trust the Belgian troops." The Dutch troops are okay. It's the French-speaking Belgian troops that he is constantly worried about. He has Nassauers that are underneath him. In Quatre Bras, a Nassau battalion will break the battle 2 days before Waterloo. Wellington will ride over there to try to rally the Nassauers, and they'll start firing at him. And he decides at that point to let them rally themselves. And then there's Hanoverians and more Brunswickians. So it's a really odd army that's put together. It's not one of Wellington's best armies. As he says, we admit it, it's not a very good army. And that's one of the reasons why they sit. And they don't do anything other than let the French pound at them. How am I doing for time, Rich? You looking at me, sir? Flex, quick overview. Am I good? Okay. He goes to Elba for less than a year. He crosses the border on 15 June. There's two battles at Quatre Bras and Ligny on the 16th of June. 2 days later, the Battle of Waterloo with this torrential downpour the afternoon of the 17th of June. 4 days later, he will go back to Paris. He will try to rally. There's soldiers and armies rallied. He's really trying to get his political support. He can't get that political support, and he'll do a second abdication. And about 3 weeks of trying to figure out what he's going to do, his brother Joseph saying, come to America, come to America. Napoleon will say, no, I'm going to give myself up to the British and put myself under the good graces of the Prince Regent of England, which was probably not the best thing to do. Joseph does go to America, buys a big piece of property in Bordentown, New Jersey, and will live there for many years. Just Napoleon, you can see where he's getting up on the Belgian border and will try to split the two armies. And that's how it's going to look. And we can talk about some of the mistakes and changes because I think my near time. Yeah, okay. What's the so what of all this? This idea of military revolutions and what happens in society affects the armies is absolutely key to understanding the way these three different armies look and also the way the armies look today. Military revolutions are unpredictable, unforeseeable, and uncontrollable. You can't say, I'm going to leverage this and I'm going to change this. All you can do is try to hold on. If you're not the best army, you can try to take certain aspects of it. But until everything kind of settles out, you really don't know what's going to go on. You ignore it at your own risk. Wellington will even say he was lucky at Waterloo. There's more Prussians at Waterloo than there are British. And Wellington says, I don't think we would have won if I wasn't here. And of course, a very modest man, but he's probably correct. And then the other aspect of this idea of military, it's a limited shelf life. Once everyone else starts to copy you and starts to also adopt these things, your advantages. The French are doing incredibly well in 1805, 1806, 1807. 1809, not so much. 1812, not at all. 1813, everyone's pretty much the same sheet of music. So you have a very, very limited shelf life. All right, thank you very much, and I'm ready to answer questions. Hold on, wait, you gotta wait for your microphone.
Can I get you to stand, please?
Yes. You have nice red hair.
Thank you.
Dr. Mark, to what extent do you think Wellington may have thought this battle was a foregone conclusion that he was going to win? Or do you think until the very last minute it was a touch-and-go thing in his own mind?
I think it's absolutely a touch-and-go thing in his own mind. He's going to say it's a close-run thing. There's a few quotes where he is looking over to his left, to the east, waiting for the Prussians to come, hoping for the Prussians to come, because his center is just absolutely getting pounded by the French. And when you look at this this timeline, there's a lot of mistakes. Ney plays a big portion of those mistakes. But there's going to be the large infantry attack under Durland's corps in the middle part of the day. It doesn't do well. The cavalry will do a big attack. But when Le Haye Sainte falls, it allows huge numbers of French skirmishers to move up the hill. Then there's a lull for about 30 minutes, and that's where the Imperial Guard comes in to do their attack. Five battalions of the Guard will attack. And it's the crisis. I mean, Wellington is collapsing his line. He's pulling people in there. And if it wasn't for the Prussians coming, Napoleon has 22 or 23 battalions of the Imperial Guard at Waterloo. Five battalions of those attack Wellington. That's because the other 17 had been pulled off throughout the day trying to stop the Prussians from getting there. And it is absolutely, Wellington, he has an unbelievable sense of confidence, and he thinks he's going to win. But he's never met Napoleon before, and it is a, as he says, a close-run thing.
You said that Lord Uxbridge loses his leg. What's the story behind that?
At near the end of the battle, Uxbridge is standing next to Wellington, or actually sitting next to Wellington on his horse, and a cannonball will come through and take his leg off pretty close to the hip. And supposedly, Uxbridge, losing your leg, says, "My lord, I've lost my leg." And Wellington's supposed to look down and say, "Yeah, I guess you have," and holds on it. Part of it is the way, as an officer in that time period, that you weren't supposed to show, react to cannon fire or anything like that, and the just absolute personal bravery you have to show. It was considered, it was bad form. You could lose your reputation by ducking, pulling up your horse, all those type of things. And Wellington, it's very easy to look at the Battle of Waterloo and track where the crisis of the battle is occurring at that time, because it's where Wellington is. He has almost none of his aides left by the end of the battle, because one after another, they're getting wounded and or killed. And some of them, like Fitzroy Somerset, which is actually touching, that the two, Somerset's left arm is actually against Wellington's right arm when a shot takes off Somerset's right arm. So that's how close these shells are getting to Wellington. And so it's a crisis, and you can tell where he is based on, or where the crisis is of the moment by where Wellington is on the battlefield. He just has that sense of going to the right place at the right time for the soldiers to be able to kind of shore him up as they need to.
My question's on Hougoumont. It was always my understanding that that was supposed to be a diversion, but somehow it wasn't. Can you explain how it became a non-diversion?
I'm not sure if a non-diversion is a word, is it? Hougoumont's not meant to be a major portion of the battle. It really is meant to, the line has two major, the British line here, obviously, French line, Hougoumont, La Haye Sainte, two forward positions that allows the British to have basically brigades out front to stop any kind of formations coming up in there. Hougoumont is where they start the battle at 11:30 in the morning, and the first unit's attack, a brigade attack, gets repulsed. And at that point, a commander probably would have sat back, brought up the artillery, and just pounded Hougoumont into a pile of dust. And Eugene, his stepson, is in charge, and Eugene just keeps piling in troops, and kind of forgets all his assets he has, but also why Hougoumont's important. It's just important as a forward position for the British line. You can mask it. You can go further to the west. It ends up being that a British brigade holds up about two divisions worth of French soldiers. La Haye Sainte does pretty much the same thing on the other side of the line. It's finally when La Haye Sainte runs out of ammunition late in the day that the French are going to take it. And that's when huge amounts of skirmishers are going to be able to move in and start to attrit the British line. So, but this is not the best managed battle from the French perspective. Napoleon does not seem to have his finger on the pulse of what's going on. Ney, we used to like to say in graduate school, seems he froze his brain in the Russian campaign, and it hasn't thawed out all the way yet. It's just not very well managed from the senior levels. So, you had a question here?
You mentioned that the French drill master has taught the recruits to aim rather than merely level their weapons. And wasn't that also the case with Steuben in the American Revolution? And so what is it about citizen soldiers that lends them to aiming rather than merely leveling their weapons?
Interesting question. That's a much bigger question than I really have time to go into, I think, in all the detail, because it gets back to that idea that you can not stay shoulder to shoulder in ranks, that you can trust citizens to be able to, you can't fire these weapons laying down, but you can certainly fire them from behind a tree, you can fire them from, and you can then trust them to come back to the ranks. In these armies that have absolutely harsh discipline, that the soldiers get beaten, they're so afraid of just releasing just a little bit of that control. If you release that control, the soldier's gonna find a way to escape, leave, desert, do whatever he can. And so part of it is you don't want them to. In the Prussian army, if a soldier looks like he's gonna flee or steps backwards out of line, the NCO's behind him with a spittoon and supposed to stab him, run him through. So that way you know if you stop or go backwards at all, your own NCO kills you, so I'm gonna go forward. Not at all like the French discipline. French discipline's really kind of an interesting piece because this is an army where all the officers, or most of the officers, have risen up from the ranks because they've shown something, and they've almost by popular demand. So you get officers who lose, so much as by personal leadership, by leading from the front, but officers who lose that, soldiers don't salute them. You know, they lose their respect from their peers. All those aspects. In a lot of ways, we look at the French army as a very ill-disciplined army compared to a lot of other ones, but it's a different type of discipline. So.
Does the term militia in this battle have the same connotation and culture as in the Civil War? Our Civil War?
Yes and no. And I say that because by the time of our Civil War and the militia has become a drinking club, has become a fun type of thing to do. No, in this time period, it's the same. It's a popular, local-based type of thing, but the motivation is still there. The Prussians are going to have the problem with the Landwehr and their militia. As the threat of Napoleon and the Napoleonic era ends, their militia forces by the 1820s, 1830s are getting pretty much to be as effective as the American militia movement is in the 1840s, 1850s. It just doesn't have that same popular draw militia. You know, people aren't willing to buy you a beer anymore at the gas house, so it kind of loses its way. But because the threat to France, I mean, the threat France does to Prussia, I mean, Prussia really is afraid, Frederick Wilhelm, that Russia's going to cease to exist. Napoleon, after the Battle of Jena-Auerstadt, takes away about 1/6 of the Prussian lands, but it's 1/3 of the Prussian population. And so they reduce it to a second-rate power. And the fear is that if you do something and lose again, that Prussia as a state will cease to exist. So. Tom, you had a question?
Yes. Most commanders, when they face Napoleon, lose and lose badly. Wellington faces Napoleon and he wins. This is the first time he faces Napoleon. Is he just lucky, or is he a more effective commander than Napoleon on this day? And if so, what made him more effective?
Yeah, I think in a lot of ways he is more effective because he understands his troops better, and he uses the reverse slope. His soldiers, for the most part, are all hidden behind the reverse portion of the hill, so they're not getting pounded by the French artillery all day long. But he is lucky. He is absolutely lucky. If the battle had started earlier in the day, the crisis would have come not at 7 or 8 o'clock at night as dark's coming. The crisis would have been there at, you know, 3 or 4 when the Prussians are still far away. Despite all Napoleon's mistakes, it's very, very close to being it. And should address, too, that Waterloo is one of those fascinating battles because it's probably the most written about battle in history. There are some aspects, and of course the bicentennial is coming up, and it's a big deal since there was not a centennial for the battle because of the First World War. Researching this, I found three different scholarly articles about the weather at Waterloo. The big piece, they talk about the rain the day before, making it so Napoleon attacks it, but you can get the barometric pressure. You can find out how much rain, where the front came from, because there's articles are there. There's no other battle that has that level of fidelity to it, of what went on. And one of the other interesting pieces, a Captain Sybourne in the British Army will start to, he wants to make a model to commemorate this battle using little figures. And so what he does is he creates all these interviews with literally thousands of officers of the British Army, the King's German Legion, who were there, to put together what happened at different time. And Seiborn's books on the battle are fantastic, because he interviews all these guys, and they all write down their stuff. And he makes this huge model, and I can't remember, it's like 120,000 little miniature figures. And he puts it together, and he makes it of the crisis, right about 8 o'clock at night, when the British line almost breaks, and the Imperial Guard gets repulsed. And Wellington sees it, and he's absolutely infuriated, because there's all these black uniforms. There's more Prussians on the map than there are red British. And so Seiborn, who's put all his personal money into doing this thing, it doesn't get accepted, and it basically gets put into a barn somewhere. He tries for a while to have a private company allow people, you know, for a pound to go see this Seiborn model, but pretty much it never gets displayed. There's a portion of it now at the National Army Museum in England, or Britain, but it's amazing, because Wellington realizes how close it is and how much the Prussians do, but the farther away from the battle you get, the less you kind of talk about the Prussians, the more you don't talk about how great the Iron Duke is. And he is, absolutely. But it's not him all by itself.
Doctor, you mentioned the weather. Do you think if it didn't rain, we would have seen a completely different Waterloo?
Yeah, you may have, but here's the problem with the weather. Okay, they talk about the afternoon. It's about 4 in the afternoon. The British Army's retreating back, and they say the clouds just open. It is like buckets of water coming down, and the soldiers march through the night. It kind of forces everyone to get to the roads. You can't, with the freshly plowed fields, get on there. But there's just tons and tons of water and standing water. Now, the next day, 18 June, it's not especially hot. It's not a sunny day. They talk about at times where the fog, which is part of the weather, but part of the gunpowder lifting, that much rain doesn't go away in a couple hours. You know, everyone says, oh, well, Napoleon's waiting 6 hours for the ground to dry up. The ground's not drying up in 6 hours. You know, go out to a farm field that's gotten tons of rain, it's still muddy. Part of it is the problem is Napoleon doesn't think much of Wellington. He doesn't think much of the army. He doesn't think there's a big rush. He thinks the Prussian army has been defeated, is moving off towards the Rhine River and not north to where he's going. So this idea that somehow he would have attacked earlier, I think if it was a bright sunny day, he still would have leisurely gotten up, had a breakfast, gotten everything together, and then attacked. It might have been a little bit earlier, but it wasn't for waiting for the ground to dry up. Chip.
Mark, an excellent presentation. Thank you very much. In terms of innovation, are there any insights or lessons you would see from Europe in 1815 that might be applicable to the Middle East in 2015?
Chip, why do you have to give me the hard question there at the end there? Nationalism is an interesting piece. This idea of how a single country is put together and is absolutely motivated, I think is a huge piece. And when you have countries that have more tribal loyalty than national loyalty, you talk about a state, but it hasn't gone through that revolution, the French Revolution. It's still not a nation in arms, which is what's so interesting about the Jordan in the last day or two, where they've talked about how it has come together as one country because of the burning of their pilot. I think that's probably the biggest piece I would take away from this. What's interesting to me is I think the Prussians, of the three armies, because they pick and choose. They have to be so careful to take the right things, the right lessons, to try to keep the king in power. And Frederick Wilhelm, we could go on a long time about him. He is not very decisive. He is not. He has a third of his officer corps resign in 1812 because of the policies of Prussia. Napoleon doesn't have much to think about him. He talks about Queen Louisa in 1806 is leading the war party. She's the one who's really pushing for war. Napoleon will say Queen Louisa is the only man in Prussia. So he doesn't have much. He doesn't have much respect for Frederick Wilhelm. So, yeah. Wait for the baton. Here we go.
How much weight would you give to the Battle of the Cornfield at the cornfields and the Imperial Guard?
When you say how much weight, what do you mean in the...
Are things starting to change as far as Napoleon's concerned?
Yeah, and what you're really talking about is the crisis back here at 7 to 9 o'clock. By this time, the British Army is getting pretty close to the end of its tether. They're running low on ammunition. A lot of these squares are being, you know, pretty brutally hit. And so when the Imperial Guard comes up there, it is pretty important. One of the things they talk about is when, because of the reverse slope, the French don't see the British line. The thought is that as they start to see Wellington pull the troops back to the reverse slope, and you start to see all these casualties and everything go back, they think it's a general retreat. They think that the British have already started to fall. So as the Imperial Guard comes up, they say that suddenly Wellington's go order the guards up, and 1,500 of them stand up and fire. You know, right? They say it looks like it's just out of the ground. Suddenly 1,500 red-coated soldiers come up and start doing it. And I think it is critical. If they were able to stand, if they were able to push it through, Wellington's army would have broken. And you know, the one thing about this, it's a terrible position. You don't fight a battle, major battle, with a big woods behind you and expect to have to withdraw through those woods. And Wellington, in a lot of ways, is lucky. If he had to withdraw, this would have really prevented him and possibly could have led to large portions of the army being captured or at least destroyed. But it's part of the use of his terrain, part of the use of that, how the army, the French army itself, has become brittle. And it's five battalions where it could have been 22 or 23 battalions of the Imperial Guard. You know, one of the things they talk about is Colburn and the, I think it's the 52nd foot, will actually be able to come out and flank the Imperial Guard column. Well, they're able to do that because there's only five battalions. If there was 17 or so battalions, Colburn's line would have been standing there too, getting hammered. So it's a critical fight, I think. And, you know, the other thing is, there's still a lot of French troops. I mean, just because the Army of the North, 128,000 are defeated, there's at least 113,000 around Paris, another 190,000 in garrisons and various stages of depots, in stages of training. It doesn't have to end. This does not have to be it. But it's part of it's Napoleon's getting sick. He's going to die 6 years later. Whether it's stomach cancer, poisoning, a mixture of the two is always one of those questions that goes up there. But he is not in the top of his game. So. But you gotta wait.
On this map in particular, I have always thought that Grouchy, on the right flank there, his mission was to try to intercept Blücher. Is that correct? Number one, and number two, if it is correct, did he simply miss?
That's not a really good map, and I put it in here, and I kind of hope no one would notice. But you picked it up. And I say that Grouchy is supposed to. And what really ends up happening is there's four corps. There's two Prussian corps here, and there's two Prussian corps here. These two get beat up pretty badly. But these are the two corps that actually come across like this. And Grouchy's going to follow the other ones up this way. The day after Waterloo at Wavre, there's a battle. Grouchy, with his corps, is going to beat the Prussians. Poor Grouchy hasn't heard that Napoleon's been routed, thinks he has done this great battle. And it's only when he's up there beating the Prussians that he suddenly finds out that, what? The Emperor's army's been routed. And he then does a magnificent rear guard action and pulls back and extricates his corps. So the map's really not that good. But we've run out of time. I should mention one last thing. That particular eagle, there's a new exhibition at the British Museum that opens up. I think it actually opens today. And that eagle, that photograph, is from their gift shop. And I'm hoping my children get it for me for Christmas. It's an actual size, made from the mold, French Imperial Eagle. It's only 895 pounds. If you join the British Museum, it goes down to 695 pounds. So I'm going to be really good this year and hope. All right, well, thank you very much.